G'day guys, I think I'm being mic'd up here, and if I'm not, I've got a bit of a foghorn of a voice normally, but thanks for the opportunity of coming up and telling you my journey and my story. But I do know that if any one of you were to get up here and start giving me your story, it would probably be more interesting than what I'm about to say now. And I don't know about legendary, I think that's a bit of an exaggeration, but anyway, there we go. Look, one thing with me, which you'll learn after about 45 minutes, and I realise that it's just between me and Frogmore Creek, so I'm bringing up the rear of your day, so we'll see how we go on that. But you'll get to know that I don't take myself too seriously. Okay, I've got children and they always bring you back down to earth, if you know what I mean, very quickly. And I'll give you an example of that. My daughter, Mia, when I was heading off to the Australian Telstra Awards, and we had won a few things in Tasmania, and we went to Sydney. And as I walked out of my place at Bruny Island, Mia said to me, "So, Dad, what is an entrepreneur?" Okay? And with pleasure, I told her what I thought an entrepreneur would be. When I happened to win the Australian one and something in sustainable business as well, and I mentioned up on stage what had happened, and I got an email from someone who said, "I checked your daughter's comments and thought it was great. No one's doing it. We'll patent it, even though I don't think you can patent it, but we'll send you a T-shirt, you know." And I never got a T-shirt, but that's part of the story anyway. And the other one, you know, I do a little bit of talking around the place every now and then, and I remember heading off to a Australian Safety Management Authority, it was, and I was a keynote speaker, about 600 people, and they were having canapes before I sat down, you know, on a table and having a meal. And I tend to go everywhere like this. In fact, 2 days ago I was speaking in Parliament House like this, and I was the only one in shorts, you know. Anyway, this lady came up to me and said, "You know, who are you, and you know, what are you doing?" And I said, "Don't tell anyone, but I just live around the corner, and I can usually knock about 3 or 5 quick drinks into me and some food before I'm booted out." Anyway, and everyone else was in their penguin suits and evening dresses and stuff. Anyway, I sat on the toffee table up the front, and I got introduced up on stage, and way up the back, you know, a long way back, you heard a little tee-hee-hee sort of laugh. So I did get her up on stage and thanked her very much for not kicking me out and all that sort of thing. And I could keep waffling about similar stories. An Institute of Professional Bankers got me to talk once, and he said, "You're Robert." I said, "Yeah." He said, "You're on in about 25 minutes. And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Good, that gives you enough time to go and get changed." And, you know, so I didn't have any other clothes. So anyway, I better start. So the options weren't too good, really. But anyway, look, like anyone, I was sort of born at a very young age. And my first real job was when I was 12 years old. I said to Dad, "Can I borrow your dinghy and go fishing over the school holidays?" And he said no, because I'd wreck his boat. But he said, "I'll lend you $3,000 at 10% interest for 10 weeks. And if you don't have the loan paid back, I'll give you the difference between what I sell the boat," you know, the bank routine sort of thing. Anyway, I worked my butt off and I sold mullet, pike, salmon, cooter, mackerel, mullet, 5 for a dollar, trumpeter and trevally, a dollar each, craze, $10 each. And in 10 weeks, I earned just over $6,000 on a push bike, selling them through Blattons Bay and Kingston and Tinderbox. And I remember door knocking every house and crossing those who didn't take fish and putting a tick on the numbers that did. And I remember this moderately old lady say to me, "Robert, don't knock the door next door. He's a fisheries officer." So if I had knocked that one, my whole life might be different to the way it is. But I earned just over $6,000 in 10 weeks, and I was 12 years old. Dad didn't repossess my boat, which was good. And I kept selling to teachers and those same people on weekends and holidays and that sort of thing. And then Dad and Mum sort of, when I was 16, I'd left home, and they, even though I went back home 3 nights a week for a decent meal sort of thing, Dad and Mum said, "Time to get a real job." And I remember I applied for about 10 jobs, and I think I was offered about 6. And the one that I, I took was working for a credit union. Back then it was one savings and loans looking after the public service. Anyway, I learned some really important things in life. I started as a teller and then a field officer and then a loans manager and that sort of thing. And the head board member, Fair Dinkum, said to me, if I want to go places in life, I'd have to change my laugh, you know. So try and work that out. And the boss was off sick a lot, and I'd been doing his job for about 6 months or so. And so the same head board member said on the second interview for his job that the only reason you won't get this job, Robert, is because of your age. So I was 21, so I actually resigned the next morning because at that stage I was earning nearly three times what I was in the credit union, fishing on weekends and holidays and that sort of thing. So I wanted to become a bum and sort of, you know, work for 4 months and then travel for 8 months and 7 months or so and then do nothing else for the last couple of months. Anyway, the type of person I was, though, when I caught a lot of fish, so too did everyone else. The beach price would always go down, the retail price would always stay up. And so the type of person I was, I bought then a retail outlet and sold the fish. It was Kingfisher Seafoods at a place called Kingston. I had a ball, had an incredibly good good team there, and without a good team I certainly would have been stuffed without any doubt at all. But I remember clear as a bell this guy hassling me all the time, and I don't mock what anyone does in life, but I knew Amway was not for me, you know. So he'd come into the shop and sort of say, have I got a deal for you, and kept on saying, come along. Anyway, I was working my butt off. The sort of typical day was I'd get up in the morning, having slept in the bottom of a boat, an aluminium dinghy, and at about 5 o'clock in the morning I'd get fishing, and then I'd fish till about 11 o'clock in the morning, and then I would go into the restaurant, take away fresh fish outlet till about 8, 9 o'clock at night, and then I'd head out onto the water, and about midnight I'd go to bed, and that was sort of what I was doing. So it wasn't very sustainable, so I'd been doing it for nearly 5 years, and it was then I went to this bloke and listened to the Amway spill one night, and I then walked out having shaken his hand and sold the lease of Kingfisher Seafoods for $250,000 plus stock. And it showed me deep down what he thought of Amway without any doubt at all. But so I did then, I went back to what I felt safe doing, which was fishing. And Dad and Mum said there was no future in fishing, but I thought at that time, and still do, think that it was absolutely brilliant to do and really did enjoy it. I'd take a lot of friends with me and their friends and relatives and that sort of thing. And we used to go underneath the highest sea cliffs in the southern hemisphere. We'd go into caves up against blowholes. We'd share it with all the locals, which was tens of thousands of seabirds, thousands of seals, dolphins, whales. And it sowed the seed what I started in 1999, which was Bruny Island Cruises. Now, just before I did that, my wife and I, we hadn't lived in a house together, just a caravan, but we happened to be playing Monopoly one day in the caravan with some friends when the phone rang, and someone had accepted an offer that we had made on six cabins, which was ridiculous. They were stratum titled, they were really run down, no running water, they were on Bruny Island, and really run down, and we bought those for $100,000, which was really funny, because to live with your partner at the time, and having never lived in a house and suddenly owning six of them was really quite a funny thing to do. But in 1999 I started Bruny Island Cruises. I started with a little 12-seat boat and managed to chase after rental cars in good weather. I hate admitting that, saying, have I got a deal for you sort of thing, to try and fill just 12 seats on a boat. I'd go around all the campsites at 6 or 7 o'clock in the morning, once again to try and fill 12 seats. And I managed to lose $40,000 in the first year, but the trend was looking good. I think I took 1,200 people in the first year, and so many people said to me, I told you charters wasn't going to work in Tasmania. And I went against, in my life, many times, some things I've done are really quite hard, and I think all of you would know the number of times that you've changed direction in life, you usually think, why did I do that? Everything was so smooth and under control before. But then when you do it, you know, you sort of do it tough usually for a little while, and then, you know, often it becomes the best thing that you have done, or at least that's what's happened to me. So I used that one for 3 years, and in the third year, we were turning away more people than we were taking, and I was doing up to 3 trips a day, but still just with 12 people on the boat, so a big day was 36 people. And then it was time to sell that boat and upgrade. So I decided to get a 48-seat, 44-foot Noosa Cat. And having had to sell the 12-seater boat, the bank was knocking at the door, because when you build a boat, every boat you ever build always comes late, you know. So finally I got the phone call about a month late saying it's ready to, you know, for you to come up and pick it up. So I went up there. Never forget, on the front of the boat there was someone with a disc sander on the fiberglass. Fiberglass dust was flying everywhere. And I said, mate, why aren't you wearing a mask? And he said, oh, masks aren't any good. The bloody things clog up all the time, you know. So goodness knows what the occupational health and safety standard was and that sort of thing. There wasn't even an engine in the boat. So I had to bribe with the good old cash, with beers, counter teas, to get the guys working, because my butt was completely on the line. And finally, we did the, about another month later, we did the first water trials. And we just put it in, went up the Noosa River, and then I remember coming back, just saying goodbye to everyone, and then filling it up and going out of the Noosa River and heading right for Tasmania. And I remember clear as a bell, on the south east corner of Tasmania is an island called Tasman Island, and from there you head straight to Bruny Island, which is where I was heading to. And I remember a pod of dolphins coming up, and the bank was knocking at the door because, you know, everything was running a bit late and there wasn't any cash flow. And when the pod of dolphins came, the emotion got too much for me, and I remember bawling my eyes out, you know. And I got to Adventure Bay on Bruny Island, and there's my beautiful wife, Michelle, and my 2 kids. And I made the fatal mistake and said to Michelle, isn't this boat beautiful? I'll never want another boat again, you know. And definitely a mistake saying that. But look, I'm going to sidetrack because I've got you for 45 minutes. And so I'll tell you a story on how Michelle and I met, which is very fitting with snow up the mountain. Anyway, I said, you know, do you want to come for a walk with a heap of us? And this has got nothing to do with what I'm meant to be talking about. And she said, yeah, she'd just broken up from a relationship and thought, yeah, there's no harm in that. And I didn't tell her that it was myself and 6 dogs, you know. So I gave her 3 dogs and I had 3 dogs. And we walked up the mountain. There was a heap of snow up there. And there's a little hut on the left-hand side. So romantically, I pulled out of my backpack, you know, bubbly flutes, and we had a bottle of champagne, and I'd made what I thought was lovely sandwiches and that, but, you know, but it did the job. You know, we came back down off the mountain to Fern Tree Tavern, and we had a Black Russian. Then the important thing was, she said to me, do you want to come back to my place for a hot drink or something? Now, if you know me, I don't drink hot drinks, so I went for the something. Okay. Anyway, I ended up having to get stuck with a hot Milo, you know. And I think in my life I've only had a hot drink twice, you know, and in my life. But also, she was she's an artist, a good artist, but at the time, well, you know, she was a student at the art school back then, and she was doing a holiday job at Muir's just along here. And I remember, cool as a cucumber, walking in barefoot through a wet floor into the blast freezer, where I had some bait to go crayfishing, and my feet stuck to the blast freezer floor. Anyway, so I very coolly just shouted, Michelle, Michelle, and in the end, with a bit of panic, anyway, they were stuck completely, and we pulled the feet off in the end, and we left a bit of skin on the floor. And so I think that was another one that sort of imprinted into her memory a bit. But anyway, she's an incredibly lovely lady. So I'm back to the jetty now. Yeah, that's right. There's no doubt about that, you know. Anyway, so we're back to the jetty, and Noah just woke up in Michelle's arms and sort of said, hi, Dad, as if, you know, I'd been swimming in the water down below for the last few weeks. Me, I knew what was going on, but I dumped the boat on a mooring and then swam in, because we didn't have a dinghy and I hadn't thought that far ahead. Anyway, so I used that boat for 3 years, and same sort of thing happened, you know. At first it was nice and busy, third year in, we were turning away stacks of people doing up to two trips a day. So it was the time to decide whether I went for multiple boats or be happy at the size I was. Again, against everyone's advice, because they said the only reason you're popular, Robert, is you're skippering all the trips and, you know, it's part of the character and part of the service, etc., etc. But again, going against what most advice was, I went for three boats that was all different, you know, the steering up the back, fully air-conditioned at the front, you know, and it meant that in bad weather, you'd get so cold and you'd have to rely on a wood fire and red wine to fix it up at the end of the day, and whiskey more recently. But in 90% of the days, these style of boats work really well. So we then had, for Bruni, three boats built for that, and had to treble the turnover to make the same amount of money, but starting to take a lot bigger numbers, to the point that I didn't really want it to keep expanding at the rate that it was expanding at. So I decided to expand to another site, which was Tasman Island Cruises, which is out of Port Arthur, and we had a couple of boats built for that. And that it was an exact duplicate of Bruni Island Cruises, but another setting. Didn't have to go through the growing pains because we'd done every year, every winter, we'd put our feelers out to another network. Very first year was, you know, just local accommodation and visitor centres, and then next year you'd spread it out to maybe the masseuses and the hairdressers, and probably the only reason I'm so busy is I give away so many trips, you know. But then interstate, without understanding really how the network of, you know, travel agents and everything works, and then internationally as well, and more every year. And I think now you can, even though they don't, you can book my products in over 300,000, you know, places throughout the world now. But things like Stu and the team at Business Events Tasmania are really, really important. We love to do things a little bit differently and try and make things tailor-made as well. But it's really exciting, and, you know, every partnership that we have in every area is so important, and without those partnerships would be absolutely nothing. But with the success after Tasman Island Cruises, we decided it was at the stage where my kids went to high school and there was no high school on Bruni Island. So when we moved up as a family to Hobart, I wanted to justify my existence in Hobart. So I set up two new tours out of Hobart. One was Iron Pot Cruise, which is just a 2.5-hour cruise of the Derwent River, which is really great. We had three boats built for that, but also one called Tasmanian Seafood Seduction, which still is the only tour in the world where legally you can jump in and get abalone and sea urchin and serve it on board the boat with live lobster and that sort of thing anywhere in the world. So really lucky to be able to do that. We also did a land-based tour of Bruni Island called the Bruni Island Traveller. And more recently, we had, with the opening of the Three Capes track, if you haven't done it, it's absolutely awesome, and I recommend big time. It's a three-night, four-day, feel like you're on top of the world, you're on top of the highest sea cliffs in the Southern Hemisphere. We went as a family and did it in April last year in about 60 knots of wind, and I got told by someone who shouldn't have that when you get to this one particular spot, which is there's a place called Cape Pillar where you can actually go out onto a rock and it's 300 metres straight down, and the track is only about probably 10 foot off the track, so even that is very spectacular. But my son and I got a rock and we threw it off this chute, and 5 seconds later, I'm not kidding, it shot back up over our head and into the bush. And you wouldn't think that's possible. My son said, "Hey, Dad, if I jump, would I shoot back too?" And I said, "I don't think we'll be trying that, Noah." But anyway, so it's a beautiful thing. If you get a chance sometime, come back and do it. It is absolutely awesome. And we love Deloitte's. They did a study on first year. It'll be 3,000 people, increasing at 10% every year for the next 10 years. And then they upgraded that when they already had 4,000 bookings for the first year to maybe 6,500, but it was an incredible success. Between the federal and state government, $26 million had been spent on the walk and the accommodation, and we're very proud to be part of Parks and also the historic site. and I believe it's an incredibly good product. Also just last Tuesday, it was publicly announced that after 10 years in the making, and that's another reason when you get told something's impossible, you sort of, you have to just keep ramming your head against a brick wall till cracks appear and then get through the hole that appears. But it's been announced that we're opening up in Wilson's Promontory in Victoria, and which I'm very excited about, you know. And again, I'm just so lucky to be privileged enough to be given that opportunity, because it is the heartlands of national parks in Victoria, and it is such a beautiful place. And if you can Google something called Skull Rock later today, and you'll see an incredible thing that they found cannonballs in, that, you know, and it's off the show beautiful, same granite as Tasmania, and we hope to open in October 2018. And the problem there is you weren't allowed to put any infrastructure in, so I had to work out how we could use boats that don't need jetties and that sort of thing. So I actually went and roused up the US military, and they spent $10 million on R&D on an idea that I had in my head, and that was matched by the New Zealand government. And it's quite incredible now that we're going to have boats that look like our boats in Hobart, but without roofs. But when you come to the beach, running gear like 747s come off the boat, and we just drive through the surf straight up the beach. And I can't wait. They're going to be so cool. So I'm really excited about that. But anyway, close to my heart, ever since I've been in business, I've always wanted to give back, and philanthropic work has been really close to my heart. In the first year when I started, maybe about 19 years ago, you know, we'd pay for the Learn to Swim program of the local school, we'd do beach cleanups, I'd donate a few prizes, and each year more and more and more happened. And roughly, I lose track of time, but about 8 years ago, we set up the Pennycott Foundation. And 2 years ago, we gave to 161 organisations or projects of our own. This year, we actually gave to 311 organisations or projects of our own. And some of them are really quite big. We do island restorations, which make islands the way they were before human intervention. And one called Tasman Island, we eradicated feral cats that were killing 50,000 seabirds a year and had been doing it for the last 30 years. And we also last year did one called Big Green Island, which had we killed tens of thousands of rats that had been killing around about 40,000 seabirds a year, and been doing that ever since farming has been on that island, which now is up to its third generation. And, you know, we've done so many things. I could talk for so long about all the different philanthropic stuff we do, but an interesting one that we're taking on at the moment is there's a French rabbit on a place called Breaksea Island going into Port Davey on the southwest corner of Tasmania. And we're working with the parks and also some volunteers, and it will be our money that does it. But the French rabbit, the French government's worked out that the French rabbit there has a more pure French DNA than the French rabbits in France, because of those naughty Italian and Spanish rabbits. And so they've said that they want 24 to get their DNA pure the way it was. So I told them to come and get the whole bloody lot and save me about $100,000. But they still only want 24. Anyway, so that's a project that we're doing at the moment. And also there's an island just off the Derwent called Betsy Island, and that's got the same French rabbit on. Someone called Lady Jane Franklin wanted to make a fortune by the Chinese fur trade. It was a dismal flop, a real bad business decision, but the same rabbit's there anyway, so we're probably going to target that one in about 5 years. But probably the biggest philanthropic thing I did, maybe you could call it my midlife crisis, you know, was when I went around Australia in 2011 in a 17-foot rubber dinghy with 8 inches of freeboard. And as you do, I got my operations manager around one night. We had a few whiskies and half a bottle of wine and some food. And at the right time, I said to Mick, how about we make a difference to the world and try and assist Bill Gates and the Rotary International to eradicate polio from the planet. And you know the old little jacaranda atlases, the little paper ones. You know, we opened up Australia and it didn't look very big on a map, you know. And anyway, without the adjectives, Mick said, you're mad, but there was quite a few adjectives there. But after a bit more drinking and looking at Google Earth, we'd planned the trip, and 3 months later, we did leave. We wanted to document it, so we actually had a look at, you know, cinematographer wanted, go around Australia, blah, blah, blah. We had 200 and something expressions of interest, and when it ended up being only, you know, they realised that it was a 17-foot dinghy, no toilet, 8 inches of freeboard, it went down to 3 people. One didn't turn up for the interview. One, to this day, Mick reckons we should have gone because she was a 26-year-old Polish girl, and even if she only lasted a couple of weeks, Mick reckons that was worth a crack. But the one we went for was someone called Zorro, and I checked his driver's license, and it really was Zorro. And I could talk for half an hour, probably more interestingly about Zorro than what I'm talking about here now, I reckon. But he did the job. Fair dinkum, he thought that the dinghies that we were going in was the dinghies to the mothership, which was round the corner. And all of his friends had a sweepstake on how far do you think Zorro will get, and they all guessed Brisbane on the first way round, you know, so it was not very, very high. But anyway, look, I'll do the quickest whip round Australia, but it was quite interesting in Sydney in New South Wales. The day before we left, Australian Safety and Management Authority said to me, it's totally inappropriate what you're doing, you're going to kill yourself. And so I said, how about just, and we're not going to let you go, and it should be 3 years in the planning. Anyway, I said, well, how about just give us 10 questions? And they gave us 10 questions. Then I think they realised that Mick and I were two ex-Tasmanian fishermen, and what would be the great loss anyway? You know, so they did ending up letting us go. And in New South Wales, the first two fishing boats that we came to was they were throwing bins of fish over as we approached, and we were two bright yellow boats. And so it was pretty obvious that they thought that we were fisheries, so they were getting rid of their loot that were undersized or illegal or whatever. So we didn't go to any more fishing boats, but probably one of my favourite stories was a place called Restoration Island. Now, this is worth Googling, okay, when I finish this little story. The guy, Dave, who's a bit of a hermit there, he came down to the boat and because we had not many people, especially ladies, he just turned around and went back up to his humpy, and we just caught a fish, so we thought we'd be cooking that on the beach. This is just where crocodiles start, this is just where crocodiles start, and in the end he came down with some homebrew. Anyway, he said, come on and have a meal with Miranda and I. So we went up there, and we had a meal, round table about half the size of that, and it's the only time come bedtime that we shot out and slept down near the beach, because I'm not kidding, Miranda was a mannequin. And the story gets better, okay? And it's the first and only time in my life where I've seen someone get drunk, eat her meal, drink her drink, and then come bedtime, we just didn't want to know what was going to happen. Yeah, so we left them alone. Anyway, but do Google Miranda, Restoration Island, and you'll see who I had a meal with, okay? Okay, anyway, the whole of Australia was incredible. Generosity of Australians was just incredible. When we got to Darwin, Weipa to Gove actually was 320 miles straight across the Gulf of Carpentaria. And we were 160 miles offshore, waves as big as telegraph poles. Mick was in one boat, I was in another. I tied Zorro to the back seat, which is really important because we would have lost him overboard, and waves were just every 20 seconds coming aboard and washing right through the boat. When it came daylight, because we did 29 hours non-stop, you know, you realised you just shouldn't be there. And when we came into Gove, we had a beer and sort of woke up, really. It's amazing what a beer does when you're really buggered. And they did a fundraiser, and we ended up having to see Indigenous elders because we hadn't arranged any permits or anything for getting through up there. And after about a 15-minute talking to the elders said to me, Robert, and patted me on my back, he said, permits were for white fellas, not for people like him and me. And, you know, when you look at my skin, it doesn't come any more white, you know. And anyway, so we also decided Zorro has a girlfriend called Sarah, which is worth Googling too. And she's about 15 years younger than he is, and she's a Marilyn Monroe impersonator. So Mick and I decided that it probably wasn't the first time that Zorro had been tied to a seat before. Yeah, but anyway, that's another story. Anyway, the whole of Australia was incredible. We had crocodile stories. We had so many different stories. We had lots of turtles, sea snakes taking up areas as big as this that we drive into, and sleep at night with sea snakes everywhere, and, you know, and crocodiles and that, and the dolphins and seals and whales. It was just incredible. Coming around the bottom end of Tassie, we to Victoria, we went through London Bridge in the Great Ocean Road, which has a good story that most of you wouldn't know, and that is London Bridge, a number of years ago, probably about 10 years ago, the end of it fell down and five people got stuck on the outside, and they had to get choppered back by the chopper company, and two of them were having an affair. And that's how they broke it to their workmates and their families. And they both had taken sickies that day. And they couldn't explain the front page of the newspaper that went all around Australia sort of thing. Anyway, so then we got to Tassie, and we lost 10 days through bad weather for the whole of Australia. And five of those days, six of those days were in Strawn. And we were so close to home, and the hardest thing was being away from family for that time. And I remember coming down the west coast of Tasmania at about 5 knots, and we came into Bruny Island, and I had to go over a bar at about 11 o'clock at night, and I'd been across that bar thousands of times, but never in the dark. And as Maxwell Smart would say, I missed it by that much, you know. Anyway, we came in, and I remember giving my wife a hug and my daughter a hug, and my son and I, about this far away, eyes just met, and we just bawled out. You know, both of us cried because we hadn't seen each other. And, you know, my kids had been with me since they were three every day on the boats as part of, you know, of the tours and that. So it's the first time I'd been away from them. We came into Hobart with hundreds of boats and thousands of people. Finished it in Sydney. The last day between Ulla Dulla and Sydney, a white pointer came in along the top, and you know, and when it got about 10 metres away from my boat, I just took off, because after going through that so much, I wouldn't want it to have been, you know, the bad finish, you know, that it could have been. But we raised a lot of money. Directly we raised, I think it was about 300,000. Then Julia Gillard flew me to her house and announced that wanted me to announce in Sydney that she was going to chip in $50 million. And when she did that, Bill Gates chipped in another $40 million on top of his already pledged $395 million. And so it's quite incredible. But I've got a head full of weird stuff, you know, that I still want to do. I've got heaps more business things, you know, I want to do. My team of staff, I'd be totally lost without. I'm a real believer in sustainability, the pillars of sustainability. I'm a real believer too that everyone who's on this earth now are the custodians of the planet, and I think that we owe it, you know, in our own way, to try and make the place a better place for having had us in it. And I'll probably stop there, because I reckon I've well and truly done my time. But thank you anyway. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, how good was that? How good was that? Thank you so much, Robert, for sharing your journey and all those funny stories. I love that your head full of weird things. I think we could have Robert here for a long time, right? Should we take him home with us? Yeah.